Good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of 2024 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have apologies from Maggie Chapman, Megan Gallagher and Evelyn Tweed. Our first agenda item is to decide whether to consider correspondence recently received from Shelter Scotland in private. Are we agreed? Yes, we are agreed. Our next agenda item is an evidence session with the Scottish Government and COSLA on suicide prevention in Scotland. I refer members to papers 2 and 3, and I welcome to the meeting Minister Marie Todd, Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport. The Minister is supported by Scottish Government officials, Morag Williamson, Head of Suicide Prevention and Distress Intervention, and Dr. Alistair Cook, Principal Medical Officer. We also have Hayley Smith, National Delivery Lead for Suicide Prevention on behalf of the Scottish Government and COSLA, Councillor Paul Kelly, Spokesperson for Health and Social Care, and Eddie Fallon, Chief Officer, Health and Social Care, COSLA. You're all very welcome to join us this morning. The Minister and Councillor Kelly will each have 5 minutes for some opening remarks, and then we will move on to questions from members. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'd like to begin by welcoming the committee's inquiry. Tragically, suicide continues to impact all parts of society, so we all have our role to play in preventing suicide. That includes us as MSPs and collectively as a parliament. Suicide is indeed everyone's business. I strongly believe we must all talk more openly about suicide and deepen our understanding of its complexity. By doing that, we can tackle the stigma that surrounds suicide and help find new ways to support people when they have thoughts of suicide. I'm very proud of the work that's happening right across Scotland to reduce suicide, and I want to record my personal thanks to everyone who is already playing their part, helping to keep people safe and to support their recovery. I've been really impressed with the volume and range of evidence that the committee have already considered, and I'm pleased that our Creating Hope Together suicide prevention strategy has been described as innovative and ambitious. The strategy was developed through Scotland-wide collaboration with communities and the many partners who are working to prevent suicide. Listening to people with lived experience of suicide was absolutely key, as was learning from the last 20 years of suicide prevention in Scotland and around the world, and that helped us to understand how Scotland's approach could be more progressive. Firstly, the importance of creating societal shifts, which we describe as outcomes, so that our environment protects against suicide. We're all better equipped to respond to someone who may be suicidal, and anyone affected by suicide in any way gets the right support. Secondly, we must tackle the inequalities in life circumstances that increase suicide risk, often called social determinants. That includes people living in poverty, experiencing homelessness or living with addiction, people who are care experienced or have been in prison, and people who are LGBT, neurodiverse or from some minority ethnic communities. Much of government policy and investments already addressing these factors, for example, tackling child poverty through our progressive Scottish Child Payment, addressing unemployment through our multi-million investment in employability services, supporting people affected by substance use through our national mission, and improving Scotland's mental health and wellbeing through the delivery of our mental health and wellbeing strategy, including evidence-based approaches such as our world-leading distress brief intervention programme and action on self-harm. Now, whilst these policies are already helping to prevent suicide, we are going further by actively weaving suicide prevention into wider action across government and society. And I want to talk a little bit about progress in delivering our strategy. Our first annual report will publish this summer with an assessment from our National Suicide Prevention Advisory Group, whose members represent and advocate for many of the groups who are disproportionately affected by suicide. I'd like to touch on a few highlights. We've improved suicide awareness and the availability of peer support across our communities. We've used clinical evidence and our time-space compassion approach to suicidal crisis to drive improvements in statutory services. And we've created new systems to capture data and evidence so that we can seize every opportunity to intervene and support someone who's suicidal. For example, introducing a suicide review and learning system. The progress has been achieved thanks to our new collective delivery model, Suicide Prevention Scotland, that brings together partners and communities right across Scotland to collaborate and learn about suicide prevention. It also includes our strategic outcomes lead partners, Samaritan Scotland, SAMH, Penumbra, Change Mental Health and Public Health Scotland, who are bringing their valuable leadership and expertise to support delivery. Looking ahead, our delivery plan for 24-25 will be published shortly, continuing the breadth and pace of work, including our drive to meet the needs of people who are at higher risk of suicide. That plan is backed by significant commitment to double our investment in suicide prevention to 2.8 million by 2026, which is well on track. The wider financial context is extremely challenging, and I'm sure we'll discuss how government is continuing to prioritise mental health. Before I finish, I want to thank our lived and living experience panels whose unique insights continue to direct all our work. And in closing, I want to restate the strategy's aim, which is for any child, young person or adult who has thoughts of taking their own life or are affected by suicide to get the help they need and feel a sense of hope. Finally, I'd like to ask for the official record to be updated to reflect the correct annual cost of the Suicide Bereavement Support Service, which in 24-25 is £309,688. I look forward very much to our discussion today and the outcome of this inquiry, which is very welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I now invite Councillor Kelly to give your opening remarks, please.
Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to give evidence today to the committee. As a voice of local government Scotland, COSLA has taken a strong position on the importance of mental health and wellbeing of our communities and the need to tackle inequalities that contribute to suicide risk. We remain committed to working in partnership with the Scottish Government to utilise the ambitions of our joint strategies, the Mental Health and Wellbeing Strategy, the Self-Harm Strategy and our Suicide Prevention Strategy, Creating Hope Together. I'd like to start by acknowledging the significant progress that has been achieved in Scotland on suicide prevention over the first year of delivering Creating Hope Together, both in terms of developing its infrastructure and in the level of activity which has been developed and delivered. The establishment of a new delivery model, Suicide Prevention Scotland, bringing together key partners, sectors and communities at a national and local level, will also contribute significantly to achieving our vision of reducing suicide in Scotland. Our approach to suicide prevention aims to strengthen partnerships across communities, building the collaboration between local and national work, ensure that the strategy is outcome-focused and that lived and living experience remains at the heart of the work. I want to highlight the importance of the work taking place across local areas of Scotland, which supports delivery of the Creating Hope Together strategy. Local delivery of suicide prevention initiatives in our communities is led by local suicide prevention leads, who are key to driving work across local areas, which responds to local needs. The work at this local level is supported by locally anchored suicide prevention implementation leads hosted with Public Health Scotland, who play an important role in ensuring local action plans respond to local need, building connections across regions, and helping to shape good practice and learning. More broadly, local authorities provide a wide range of supports in communities which contribute to suicide prevention, through the provision of social work, education, welfare, homelessness and health supports, or leisure to name a few. This support at a local level across all preventive factors is crucial, but becoming more and more challenging for local areas to do with limited resources, particularly as all local government services are under pressure and we are continuing to see the impact of the cost of living crisis. While celebrating the progress achieved to date, it is crucial that we also acknowledge the challenging financial landscape and the wider system pressures within which the suicide prevention work has to operate in. This includes the impact of cuts to core local government budgets, which will affect service provision that may already be in place, leaving a bigger gap between the current position and the asks of the strategy. We must therefore recognise the size of the challenge ahead of us in driving forward the ambition of this strategy within the context of a system that is extremely stretched. As we drive the work forward, this will require effective partnership working across all levels of society and sufficient capacity and resources to support our vision to reduce suicide deaths in Scotland whilst tackling inequalities. The strategy's whole of government and society approach reflects this shared responsibility to prevent suicide, which must span right across society, recognising that no single agency can deliver a suicide prevention agenda and that a collective approach is needed across public, private and third sectors. This will help us realise the ambition that suicide prevention is everyone's business. Local government is committed to continuing to work in close partnership with the Scottish Government and our partners across all sectors in order to reduce suicide in Scotland and tackle the inequalities that contribute to suicide risk. Thank you, and I look forward to discussing this in more detail in today's session.
Okay, thank you. Thank you both. I'm going to start by opening, asking the first question. It's been noted during our evidence sessions that death by suicide had actually increased over the scope in the course of the Every Life Matters strategy. Can I ask, when looking to understand a new strategy, creating a new hope, what work was done to try and understand what gaps there may have been in the previous strategy and any understanding of the impacts of that? The Minister, please.
I'm happy to start, and I think Morag will probably want to come in and contribute a little as well. Certainly there's a number of things which are significantly different. One is that inequalities, which will be of particular interest to this committee, are kind of ingrained as part of the core work in this strategy, whereas there was recognised increased risk in communities who experienced inequalities in previous strategies. But there was a challenge in terms of how to respond them. We've kind of built them in with the bricks in this strategy, and we hope that that will deliver for those particular communities, particularly, of course, often people don't experience just one inequality. There's that overlap, which has a particular impact. The other, let me think, I don't know, Morag, if you want to come in. Yeah.
So I think you're asking a little bit about how did we develop this strategy and the trends that we saw over Every Life Matters, and what did that mean for how we developed this strategy. I think the first thing to say is our Every Life Matters strategy was developed with as much consultation and evidence as we had at the time. And it gave us 4 years of delivering suicide prevention activity in Scotland and seeing which of those activities were making a difference. So we absolutely took a lot of learning out of both the development of that strategy and actually the work that we did and seeing the impact of it. When we came to develop the Creating Hope Together strategy, our current strategy, we did quite an extensive consultation in different formats, and myself and Hayless were part of much of that engagement. And that was with communities and partners right across Scotland, where we were listening to their experience of suicide and what they felt would be the things that would make the biggest difference. The other things we did was, as I think you'd expect, we looked at all the data that we had in Scotland, and we also worked with our academics. And I know you've heard evidence from Professor O'Connor. So he was very closely involved in helping us understand both the data around suicide trends and suicide prevention activities that make a difference. But also, he was really helpful in helping us understand, and we commissioned a review to look at international examples of suicide prevention strategies across the globe. So the other final, probably important bit of that is our National Suicide Prevention Leadership Group, who oversaw the delivery of the Every Life Matters strategy, were absolutely critical to helping us understand what was important to put in place for this new strategy, and the lived experience panel that we had in place and the youth advisory group were also critical to helping us understand what we needed to put in place. So that's quite a long kind of background to say we took a lot of learning from that. I think the things that we really shifted in this new strategy was the focus on putting equalities first. Hopefully you can see that, and also the focus on outcomes rather than just actions, and looking differently about how we delivered the strategy.
Yeah, to come in on that point, Minister, if I may, the focus on inequalities, you could say would be quite challenging in the circumstances that we're in. What challenges do you foresee being the hardest of those to overcome for this?
So I think, there's a clear link to increased suicide risk with poverty, and it is very challenging to tackle poverty in this particular environment. We've had 14 years of austerity, a political choice made in Westminster, which has had a profound impact on our public services and on our welfare system. Then we've had the pandemic, which has stretched the health and social care system. We've also had Brexit, which has had a really profound impact on both our economy and on our societies. And as we've come out of the pandemic, we've faced a cost of living crisis. So I think there's real challenges in tackling poverty. But despite that, there are measures that we are taking in Scotland that are making a difference. So we're all very proud of, in Scotland, the Scottish Child Payment, that priority of ensuring that money goes into the families with young children, recognising the profound impact that poverty at an early age has. And that's lifted 100,000 children out of poverty. Obviously, that's a very long-term investment, and it is not a specific suicide prevention measure, but tackling poverty is a suicide prevention measure, make no mistake about it. So tackling that particular challenge in this environment, and I've spoken very openly before about, particularly when I was Public Health Minister, about the challenge of the interventions that we make here in Scotland. It feels like we give with one hand and it's taken away with another. We have one hand tied behind our back because the focus and approach is so different from our Westminster government. So that does make things very, very challenging in terms of tackling poverty.
Yeah, thank you. Councillor Kelly, if I could come to you, please. Can I ask you the same? What do you feel in terms of learning from previous strategy, and also in regards to inequalities and the challenges that may arise from that?
So I think the Crane Hope Together has taken and Murdoch's covered it, many elements of the sort of previous strategy and important successful elements of it, and embedded them within Crane Hope Together. But I think the focus on inequalities, the focus on making sure that lived experience people are very much at the table, the focus to various different groups that we are reaching out to make sure their voices are heard, and that this is not just a strategy for 10 years that began last year and ends. It's going to continually develop throughout that period, and that's going to be critical to address some of the issues that probably come up actually in your evidence sessions as well, to make sure they're also part of the strategy. And in terms of inequalities, you know, that we face in society, I mean, I think we all know as elected members this is some of the toughest times for our communities, and the Minister's outlined some of the challenges that are faced by communities, quite a unique set of circumstances, and inevitably that has a significant impact on people's mental health. Local government and local authorities play a key role in some of their services, which I outlined in my opening remarks, in terms of providing support for people. And that is becoming difficult with our own budgetary positions being very challenging in recent years. And that has an impact on some key services, things like leisure facilities, which, you know, a lot of people in our communities benefit hugely from for their mental health and well-being, are at threat with these kind of budget decisions that are forced upon us. So I think we need to really factor in, and this strategy certainly does, that local government is very much committed to working with all partners across whole society to look at inequalities and the impact it has on suicide. And I saw a statistic that you're 2.6 times more likely in a deprived area to commit suicide, and that's a tragedy. It's a tragedy in any area, but we this strategy absolutely commits to looking at the issues around that, working with lived experience, to do everything we can to support people.
Okay, thank you. Now move on to questions from Marie, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning, Councillor Kelly and your officials. Some of my questions have been touched on, so I'll just kind of move on. Obviously, over the last few weeks, you know, we've spoken from witnesses and they've kind of raised issue about suicide being higher in areas, rural areas, due to obviously the limited services, etc., and obviously not wanting to access services in a such small location. Just wanted to know what actions you've taken to support people at risk of suicide in these areas. And I'll pop that to yourself, Minister.
Thanks very much. You might imagine this is an area very close to my heart as a representative for Caithness, Sutherland and Ross. There is work going on in collaboration with Samaritans, actually, and I visited the project recently at their base in Fort William to assess the risk of suicide and do some suicide prevention work amongst lone rural workers, recognising that they are a particular risk. People can be very isolated working in the Highlands, and also often, because of the nature of the work, that they do have access and means. So it's a really important piece of work. I was hugely impressed, as you might expect, by the work that the Samaritans are doing. They're very, obviously they're a national organisation with a real level of respect amongst the community and amongst the nation, but they were in this very local community working very carefully and sensitively with some of the groups that were already operating in the area. So there's a couple of local charities who are very prominent that have often, and I'm sure it's the same in every part of the country, sprung up because of tragic events in memory of people who have been lost by suicide. And I was really impressed by the sensitive way in which this national organisation had come into this local community and was working very carefully and thoughtfully and impactfully, along with the rest of the community. Really keen. I think that work reports fully is it next year. So I'm really keen to see the outcome of that piece of work, and I think it will absolutely be of interest to every other rural area in Scotland. So we have some specific work going on in rural Scotland, and as I say, I was very, very impressed when I went to visit recently by the way in which Samaritans are conducting that. I suppose in that project there's a recognition, and I'm keen to get this on the record, there's a recognition of the importance of employers and work-based interventions. And I think whilst there is evidence, when we look to learn from suicide, there is often people have sought help from primary care, so non-specialist medical help. Often sometimes people have sought specialist help, but employers are a very common theme across the board, and ensuring that employers are equipped to have sensitive conversations, recognising the role that they play in the community and the role that a supportive employment environment can have in preventing suicide is a somewhat new thing. So we're really pleased to be working alongside a group of employers in our mental health and wellbeing strategy delivery, but also in particular in the suicide prevention work.
Thanks for that. Councillor Kelly, is there anything that you might want to add, or even your officials from COSLA?
Sure, I'll just bring an idea here. Obviously that socialisation and rural part of it is vital and as part of the strategy that we look at addressing those issues specifically, and that goes across the many specific issues around groups, around considering suicide, that we look into the specifics of it. I think that I mentioned that we have local suicide leads, and I think we've got 23 councils have action plans and others are working on it. So it's really important that these are tailored to the local areas, and whether it's rural or urban, they are very much tailored to the support that's required. And that's supported obviously by the suicide prevention implementation teams at Public Health Scotland. So there's really important work going on in local communities, supported by local councils, but it's again making sure that's across the whole of society and takes into consideration the difficulties in terms of access to service that can be in rural areas and also around recruitment.
Just to echo that, and I think as well, you know, one of from your first question from Cam Adams' question, one of the differences here as well is that, you know, that there's a this is a joint strategy. You know, it's very much about the national, you know, the national bodies, but working with the local, and I think that's important. So the work that we do at COSLA, we work really closely with chief officers. Now a lot of the strategy is kind of channeled through chief officers. They've got a kind of key role here. So and we're constantly aware of the kind of pressures in rural areas because our rural members are usually our most vocal members. So we're very aware of the kind of pressures in those areas. But at the same time, you know, what we want to do is make sure that we're reflecting that kind of local need, because we all know, you know, what would be, you know, it will be different in Highland than it will be in Glasgow, but there will also be similarities as well. But I know Hayless is quite passionate about that as well. So you've been working on that a lot.
Yeah, and I guess just to kind of add in, those local leads we meet very regularly, so I meet them on a monthly basis, so they're able to help us shape what we're doing at a national level as well. So they're very embedded in the work that we're doing at a national level, you know, regardless of whether they're in rural or island or urban communities. And the other part that I think is going to play a big role in the coming years is the work we're doing with the Scottish Community Development Centre to support some community-led action research, which will be in communities, led by communities, helping us better understand what their needs are. So that will help to shape the work for the future as well.
Thank you. We've also heard...
We're all having a go at this one. Just to add on the rural dimension, we were really thoughtful about this when we were developing the strategy. And actually one of our guiding principles is making sure that all our work is relevant for urban, rural and remote and island communities. Hayless is looking at the delivery plan for each year. We're working through those guiding principles and thinking about that rural dimension. The other thing that's helping us enormously is working with the Rural Mental Health Forum and all of its members, and they are bringing such perspectives and opportunities, and I'm sure we can tell you more about that, but they're a fantastic organisation that's helping us understand the particular dimensions. And then final thing to say is when we've been looking to trial new approaches, we've often been thinking, how can we make sure that we know these will work as well in rural areas as in urban areas? So within our suicide bereavement service work, we've focused the pilots in Highland and in Ayrshire and Arran for a couple of reasons, but including that point about rural areas.
Thank you. The other issue had as well is obviously hearing about the kind of increased risk to those who are in prison, and obviously the issues as well with getting adequate support, you know, from moving on from prison. Just wanted to know if you could kind of give us a bit of detail on that, probably from the kind of COSLA point of view, Paul, if you don't mind.
Sure, in terms of, and obviously that's part of, you know, the work that goes on when somebody leaves prison, and support that can be there through local authorities, and certainly I think that should be reflected in a lot of these local action plans that are coming together and tie into what's happening, as Hayla said, at national level, to make sure that specific, again, very specific support is there, tying in also to what national support is available for individuals that leave prison. So that is a very important strand to it, and I don't know if Hayla, she wanted anything specific on that.
Yeah, so there is some action around looking at action plans in high-risk settings, and obviously prisons form one of those high-risk settings. So Public Health Scotland are leading on that work. I'm working alongside colleagues in the Scottish Prison Service to look at the refresh of their Talk to Me strategy and what that needs to look like, but thinking beyond just what happens in prisons and how we have that sort of support after release from prison, and those connections are made between the prison setting and the local community that they then go back to. So I'm making sure that feeds through other criminal justice structures as well, that's not just focusing on the prison, but what happens beyond that setting as well.
Is there sort of any charities that, you know, sort of work specifically with people who are actually leaving prison? Do you know of any? Sorry to put you on the spot, and if you don't have the information, I think the committee would be quite interested to, yeah, to find out.
I don't have the information to hand. We recently visited Edinburgh Prison and spoke a lot with the Bernardo's service there that supports families of prisoners and again, you know, follows them up on release. So, you know, we heard from them about what some of the challenges were for families and for prisoners on release. So I'm certainly happy to follow up with
That's really helpful, thank you.
We can certainly look at the work that we do alongside charities who work with prisoners. I know from previous roles in government the work that families outside do to support those connections and maintain family relationships between prisoners and their families who are on the outside. And that, whilst not particularly focused on suicide prevention, clearly has a role to play in suicide prevention.
No, I think as well the kind of holistic support is really important as well. That's me. Can I...
Okay, thank you, Marie. Now move on to questions from Paul, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the witnesses. I'd like to focus, if I can, on the potential impacts of the strategy for groups who are disproportionately impacted by suicide. I think in the evidence that we've heard, people have said that although the strategy's focus on inequalities contributing to suicide is very welcome, I think there is concern that taking a one-size-fits-all approach will sometimes mean that certain groups don't receive the particular support that they need. So I wonder, you know, we've looked particularly at LGBT plus people, we've looked at men in particular and the issues that affect them. So I wonder if witnesses might want to comment more broadly on what is being done both in across the spheres of government and across communities to try and really support these groups and take a kind of laser focus, if you like, on the issues that impact them.
I'm happy to start, but I'm pretty sure nearly everyone will want to contribute to this question. We agree that there isn't appropriate to take a one-size-fits-all approach. And we need to really understand the particular circumstances that are enhancing the risk amongst these communities in order to find the solutions in terms of prevention. There's some really good work going on across the piece in preventing male suicide. We recently confirmed additional funding of £100,000 for Changing Room Extra Time programme, which is run by Sam H. That's done via football. And I know the Cabinet Secretary visited that during Mental Health Wellbeing Awareness Week and was they had a particular theme this year of mental health and physical activity. So it was a perfect match. And he was blown away by the work that they were doing and how they were reaching out into male people, men who are at risk of suicide, using the power of football, which, as you can imagine, is something I'm very passionate about, to give them time and space to come together in a way that they wouldn't normally and to talk openly about challenges. We've got work with other organisations that specifically reach men, people like Andy's Men Shed and Men's Matters Scotland, and we're very grateful for the work that they do to support us in understanding why men are more at risk at suicide and reaching that particular group who are perhaps stereotypically a little less inclined to ask for help and support. In terms of the LGBT prevention work, again, it is difficult. So I think you'll have heard from the academics earlier on in the course of your evidence taking that the body of evidence, although improving, is perhaps a little scanty for some of these specific characteristics. And I think in that situation, all that we can do is work very closely with trusted organisations who we know work in that area effectively and are alongside those populations and try to find bespoke answers that work for them and that support them in their work. Don't know if anyone else wants to.
Yeah, so I guess there's a number of areas that we're looking at. So, you know, the Minister mentioned changing rooms and the focus on football there. We've just recently had a new element of the campaign, FC United, which is targeting men through football. And we're doing some work to look at how we have those specific campaigns targeting specific groups, recognising that, you know, tackling inequalities is part of our vision and one of our guiding principles. So those campaigns are one way of sort of identifying, you know, and targeting work at specific groups. We held an event at the end of November last year, which we called Building Connections, which is recognising that, you know, we haven't always got this right, but we want to do better. And so we brought together a wide range of organisations who are, you know, the trusted organisations working with people with protected characteristics or working with people who face stigma, discrimination and inequalities, really to hear from them about how we better work with them to help support those communities. So we are working now to deliver new sessions over the course of this year. We've got some planned in already to really focus down on work around specific groups. And the work I described earlier with SCDC, doing community-led action research, will also target two groups this year of populations of interest. So, you know, we are really beginning to build our understanding of what work needs to be done to support those groups particularly. One of the other areas I think Morag touched on earlier is, you know, building our understanding of what those contributing factors to suicide actually are. So we're building in work to review deaths by suicide. We're bringing in a new system that will help to collect that information, that will help both local areas identify where there is, you know, area gaps in provision and support for people, but also will help us at a national level shape the work that we do in the coming year. So it's really helping us understand better what we need to do.
Councillor
Gillan. Yeah, I think a lot has been covered, but I think we also have to reflect on what's come through your own committee and the evidence. You know, the attempts we made through a strategy to work with many groups through the lived experience panels and our youth work as well. However, we have to reflect that, you know, as we've touched on, that we do need to tailor the strategy and tailor the actions towards the groups that have specific issues that we want to support. And a lot of that work actually also happens in local areas. You'll see a lot of third sector and other organisations operating that do provide specific support, so we need to make sure we're matching that up to what's happening nationally. And I think Hales's last point there about data as well is really, really important, about getting the correct data for local areas so that we know specifically what's going on. We've talked about collecting data around attempted suicides as well through Public Health Scotland, and I think that's really, really important, because we know a number of people that maybe they don't complete suicide, they attempt suicide, and we aren't aware of that information, but we want to provide as much support as we can to those individuals, and also critically to break down the stigma, as we've said earlier, to make sure that all groups and individuals know that there's support available to them.
Just to add in one additional thing, we've been focusing specifically on the suicide prevention work around men, but it might be helpful to kind of just look a little bit wider. So one of our key investments on mental health and wellbeing really looks at the groups that could be more likely to experience poor mental health and wellbeing. And that's the Mental Health and Wellbeing Communities Funds. There's one for adults and one for children. And what we've done within that is really focused down, and one of the priority groups is men, and we're looking at how we can better reach men. And within that fund as well, we've got a particular focus on suicide prevention. So we've tried to look at the opportunities for those wider programmes to also support the work that we are doing. And we're really pleased that in 22-23, 300 projects across Scotland were supported, which had a particular focus on suicide prevention. So we're trying to look beyond just what's in our own suicide prevention strategy and look for those wider opportunities as well.
I wonder if I can, convener, in terms of the point about data and good quality data, I suppose measuring impact is of interest to the committee and has been throughout the evidence sessions we've taken. I think that's overall in terms of how the impact of the strategy be measured, but I think particularly in terms of this line of questioning for those groups that we want to really focus in on, how are we going to get to understand what impact is taking place? Because I understand there's a range of factors within that and a range of outcomes. So I don't know if Hayliss maybe wants to start in terms of the data set and thinking about that, and then we can maybe look at the other issues.
Yeah, so I guess the key way that we're going to be measuring impact is to look at the outcomes and you know how we are working within that outcomes framework that we published last year alongside our delivery plan. We've done a lot of work over the last year to really work out how we best do that. This isn't a case of just counting numbers, but actually being able to demonstrate the impact we're having against those long-term outcomes and against the 9 short-term outcomes that we have in the outcomes framework. So we've been working with an organisation called Matter of Focus, who are experts in kind of collecting the qualitative data and supporting that happening, so that we are, you know, as I say, not just counting numbers, but really looking at what's the contribution our work is making to reducing suicide and to supporting people affected by suicide. We're getting towards the end point of creating our outcomes pathways, which have really laid out a theory of action so that we are saying, you know, if we're doing X, this is how we expect it to contribute. We will be working with those organisations that we described earlier and with people with lived and living experience to collect that information as we go along. We've got a range of delivery partners who are supporting the work, who, you know, delivering specific actions, and part of their work will be to collect that information as we go, and that we'll have it all in one place then to be able to demonstrate the impact that we're having over the long term of the strategy. And again, I think that's really important to realise this is a 10-year strategy, so it's that impact over that length of time that's important for us to be looking at.
We have as well, we have a National Suicide Prevention Advisory Group that provides some independent assessment of progress to both government and to COSLA every year and highlight if an adjustment in our priorities is needed or a redirection of our priorities. And the members of that advisory group reflects quite a broad range of sectors who are leading work on the social determinants of suicide, like poverty, care experience, as well as partners who are working in key sectors affected by suicide, like the criminal justice sector. So we think we've got quite a broad group. We think they are, I mean, my impression is they are pretty constructive critics, so they're not afraid to hold power to account, and I think that will be useful, particularly given the financial constraints that we are all aware of, and ensuring that our focus remains exactly where it needs to be.
Catherine. I think it's key for probably local, national government and all those involved. The advisory group is very, very important, I think, to having that evaluation and monitoring of the strategy, and obviously we need to evidence the impact, which is really clear as and I think local and national government are committed to that. You know, we want to make sure it is in its first year, and I think that first year has put in quite a detailed infrastructure around the plan, and it's still developing, as you can probably see from the evidence sessions as well. So I think it's important that's a key aspect, I think, of the plan in terms of making sure that we are delivering in reductions in suicides, and so that needs to be monitored on a regular basis.
Wonder if I might finally, convener, just in terms of the broader approach, because I think strategy is important, obviously sits within certain portfolios within Scottish Government and in local authorities, but it's clear that we're going to have societal approaches to all of this. To what extent has it been, I suppose, challenging to get that cross-government, cross-authority approach? We appreciate that. There are a number of different challenges that are faced by all spheres of government. You know, is there a sense that this is cross-cutting and will be cross-cutting across those sectors? Minister, I don't know if you want to.
I mean, I think so. So my impression is, I mean, mental health and wellbeing is a key focus for the government. So it's a high priority for every ministerial portfolio. in terms of our work with local government. I don't think you would find a minister and a spokesperson that work more closely together than myself and Paul, actually, on very many areas, which reflects the priority that both spheres of government give to this work. So we work together on suicide prevention. We have launched a joint strategy on it. We've also worked together on the mental health and wellbeing strategy. We've worked together on the delivery plan of that and the workforce planning for it. We've also developed together a groundbreaking self-harm strategy, which is a really important area for suicide prevention. That's one of the biggest risk factors for suicide is self-harm, but we listen very, very carefully to our lived experience community about what was required specifically for them in order to meet their needs and reduce their risk. So the will is there, the effort is going in. There are always challenges, and every sphere of government is feeling challenges in terms of finances, but there is absolutely no doubt, and you can see it in the numbers, that this is a high priority for all of us.
And that issue is far too important. You know, we must break down any barriers that existed between national and local government. We must all commit to it. We all know the scale of the issues around suicide and mental health issues, and so these strategies are really, really critical. From a causal local government point of view, we believe we play a key role at local level. You know, and there should be a reflection of local plans, acknowledging that different areas have different requirements and different needs, and that's critical to us. But certainly, there is challenges, there's no doubt, you know, in terms of between local and national government, but these are areas that are vitally important that for all of us that we get right to help support as many people as possible. So I think it's critical that as a whole of government and society approach, I think I said in opening remarks as well, it's everyone's business. We need to get that message out. It doesn't matter. We're in local, national government, third sector, businesses. You know, everybody should take an active role in suicide prevention and in mental health and wellbeing.
Thank you, Convener.
Move on to questions from Annie Wells, please.
I wanted to come in on the last point.
Sorry.
I just wanted to kind of point you to Annex A in our action plan, which sets out a package of policies and opportunities that we saw across government and across local authorities at the point that we were developing the strategy. I would agree with the Minister when we approached our counterparts in government different government portfolios to ask them where they saw the opportunities. There was a real willingness to step in and see where there was opportunity, and we need to seize those and do even more. So we continue to look at this package and see what more we can do. We have already achieved some really explicit areas where we've integrated suicide prevention and cross policy action within the national planning framework. We now have a requirement that all proposals coming forward have considered suicide safety, and within Social Security Scotland's operations, they've got a real a process which allows them to be alert for suicide risk and then to have an escalation policy as well. So we've got some examples, and that's ongoing work, but certainly, as the Minister says, the commitment is absolutely strong on that.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you. Annie Wells, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Both the Minister and Councillor Kelly had spoken about those with lived and living experience and how they were involved in the strategy. And I would just like to ask the Minister how people from groups at a higher risk of suicide were involved in the development of the strategy. If you could expand on it a little bit for us, please, Minister.
You'll know that listening to the voice of lived experience is very important to this government. We put lived experience at the heart of our policy development and legislation often, because that helps us to get it right in the first place, but it also holds our feet to the fire in terms of delivery. So we find it is a really helpful way of working and of making sure that we close that implementation gap, that gap between what the ambition is and what's actually happening on the ground. So if we have the voice of lived experience really strong in the development of policies, that really helps us to get it right and to deliver it well. We've got a couple of lived experience panels. Yep. I think Morag would probably enjoy telling you a little bit more about that. We were wondering if it might be possible for them still to contribute to your inquiry, because it's been so helpful to us in our development. But
yeah, absolutely. So we have two lived experience panels. One is called the Lived and Living Experience Panel, and it's hosted by SAMH, hosted and supported. Safeguarding is really important to us. So we make sure that they have an opportunity to help set priorities and also then to help us understand how best to deliver on those priorities. And they all come with different experiences. So there's a range of experiences in terms of people who have been affected by suicide themselves, been bereaved by suicide, and or carers for someone who has been suicidal. We also have a youth advisory group, and that is hosted and supported by Children in Scotland and the University of Stirling. And again, they've had a really big input into both the development of the strategy and at every point where we're developing new work as well. The other thing I would add is in developing the strategy, we engaged a number of times, can't quite remember, maybe two or three times, with a forum that we've set up inside government to help us understand the experiences of different groups, particularly marginalised groups and groups who face inequalities. And that's called the Equalities and Human Rights Forum, the Mental Health Equalities and Human Rights Forum. So a good couple of times we engaged with them as we were developing the strategy, and they represent a range of different groups, including the LGBT community. And that was really insightful. So as well as doing individual engagement and lived experience engagement, the input from that forum was really helpful.
Thank you very much for that. My next question is that through the strategy's development, some felt that some stakeholders were excluded from the suicide prevention work stream. And I was just wondering how you would respond to that criticism. Do you think there was an element of people feeling excluded from the actual strategy?
Certainly, that can happen in strategy development, and where it does and has happened, what we've tried to do is reach out to those stakeholder groups and ensure that our relationship is strong going forward. So I can think of a couple of stakeholder groups where our relationship is stronger and closer now as we have worked together than it was maybe in the early days. You've heard from each and every one of us, we think suicide is everyone's business. We want absolutely everyone to be a part of the solution and to feel involved, and particularly, you know, marginalised communities. We don't want them to feel on the outside, and we don't want to impose a one-size-fits-all solution on them. So we're pretty keen to work with anyone. And if I'm not sure if you had closed evidence sessions, I don't think we've seen yet the evidence. Obviously, we're keenly observing your inquiry. But if there are particular issues that have come up during your session with lived experience that we need to be aware of, we're really keen to hear it, and we want to work with people. We think it's a really helpful thing that you're doing. You know, we're keen for Parliament to scrutinise the work that we're doing, and we're keen to improve and do the best job we can. So we'll take any pointers you have for us.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. Councillor Kelly, you had mentioned about those with lived and living experience being involved at a local level for the implementation of the strategy. I don't know if you can tell us a wee bit more about how you see that working.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously, I think the local sort of suicide prevention leads in local authority areas or coordinators and the action plans are going to be critical to reaching out to those with lived experience and those other stakeholders and groups. And I echo what the Minister said, you know, reflecting on the comments, we need to take the feedback. It's really helpful, the evidence you've taken around stakeholders that maybe don't feel they've been part of it, because at the heart of the strategy going forward is making sure that those with lived experience are there throughout the process of implementation and action. And that's certainly the case locally. And you know, locally, you know, different areas can have different networks and supports, etc., and different actions taking place. that represent different groups. So it's making sure that those leads feed that into to obviously the Public Health Scotland implementation suicide prevention officers to make sure that that's happened and it's reflected nationally what's going on at that local level as well. But really, you know, it's critical. It is a 10-year strategy at every step of the way that we absolutely bring those with lived experience, marginalised groups, with us and reflect on anybody that feels at this stage they're not part of it, that is reflected going forward.
Thank you very much for that. Oh, Hayless.
A couple of things that I think are important to build on. So you talked about lived experience at a local level. We've produced with the Scottish Recovery Network and SAMH in support with the lived experience panel. We have nationally guidance for local areas as well to help them understand how to support participation and engagement with people with lived and living experience. And I guess anything that we learn now will help us develop our next action plan. So although we have a 10-year strategy, the first action plan is for 3 years and we're already beginning to sort of collect the information and the evidence that will help us shape our next action plan as well. So I think it's really important that anything we do learn, you know, as we are going about doing the work we're doing, but also from your committee, will help to shape our next action plan too. You know, it's not a static action plan for the 10 years.
Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you.
Annie, I'd like to ask a question in regards to adequate funding. This is something that's came up with all the witnesses that we've had so far. Can I ask, in regard to adequate funding for healthcare, in particular suicide prevention strategy, how can the Scottish Government and COSLA ensure that there is adequate funding there, that it's a priority? Can I come to you, First Minister?
So, I mean, you've heard us all mention the challenging financial backdrop, but against that, we are fully committed to doubling the suicide prevention funding to 2.8 million by 2026, and we are well on track to achieving that. I think this year's allocation, 24-25, was 2.6 million, so very close to it. We have that is on a backdrop of increased investment in mental health and wellbeing as a whole, and also specific investments. I was thinking, I haven't mentioned distressed beef interventions. So I suppose it's important that we see the investment in suicide prevention as part of the whole landscape of investing in mental health. And suicide prevention is part of the core work of mental health, and all of the investments that we are making in mental health and in, you know, in general and in specific programmes like distress brief interventions has an impact on suicide prevention. The distress brief intervention, we've invested 24 million to date, and that I don't know if you've heard much about it in the evidence, but it's timely, compassionate support for people who are in distress. It's not intended to be suicide prevention work, but actually when we evaluated it, what we found was that about 1 in 10 people told us that it had reduced their risk of suicide having access to that programme. So it's really impactful. About 62,500 people have accessed it so far in Scotland. I met recently with frontline staff who can refer. So you have to be referred to distress brief intervention by frontline staff like ambulance, NHS 24, police. And they told me just so powerfully about the impact that it was having on the ground and that it reduced their distress in dealing with these really difficult situations because they had a powerful and impactful and effective tool to utilise in these really distressing situations when they're faced with people in distress. We've now got it's rolled out almost all over the country. Within the next few months, it'll be rolled out everywhere. I think it came up in the debate last week in Parliament when we were talking about the police role in responding to people in distress. Distress brief interventions can be deployed as people telephone the police by the telephone operators, and it can save police time. So it really is a very impactful programme. Again, not part of our specific suicide prevention work, but I'm very confident it's having an impact. So it's important to look at the suicide prevention budget within the work that's going on as a whole.
Thank you. Councillor Kelly.
And again, NCOS is very supportive of government of the initiatives that the Minister's outlined that maybe aren't necessarily part of the strategy itself, but very, very important around mental health. But as I outlined at the start, you know, that the local government settlement is extremely difficult, and a lot of local government services are providing support, again, not necessarily seen as being suicide prevention, but they are impactful, you know, in welfare support and our homelessness services, our social work services and other interventions that local authorities do. So the issue here for local authorities will be that if their budgets are reducing, those services could have an impact in the policy itself, and that's something we need to keep sort of in discussion with the government around, you know, because that funding and resourcing is vitally important to supporting people in our communities that need our help. And where we withdraw from services due to budget cuts, you know, it does put additional support on mental health, other areas of mental health, which are already under significant wider system pressure. So we have to acknowledge all that in the strategy as we go forward. And you've also seen other partners like Police Scotland and the Chief Constable about the impact of mental health and the job they do and the direction of travel they're going in. So we have to reflect that we need to do everything we can working together with government, and NCOS are certainly committed to that, to address those funding issues and look at what supports we can give to our communities and those that need our help.
Okay. Thank you. Question from Marie, please.
It's just around the kind of similar theme that's been with us for the last few weeks, obviously, about the concerns about funding, you know, available to kind of wider services involved, you know, suicide prevention, you know, wider mental health and obviously physical health. And there's some amazing work happening with really small pockets of money at the heart of communities. And we'll all know of community-based groups within our own area who are making a real difference, a lifeline to so many, and they're helping empower and encourage individuals to develop the skills really to manage their own mental health and physical health. And the difference that these groups have made is really, you can't even put a figure on it. But I was just wanted to ask, like, you know, are you going to commit like additional funding? And I know that, you know, budgets are really tight, but just obviously these groups are saying, you know, like, you know, just help us, you know, sustain our funding, a small pocket of money, and leave us to it, and we'll go on with it. Do you realise the importance of these services, and it's, I suppose, and how they can really support the implementation of the strategy? It's really small pockets of money, and I know we're all skint, but you know, yeah, it's working together.
So you've given me the opportunity to talk about the Mental Health and Wellbeing Communities Fund. Which is, as you say, a small sum of money. It's £15 million per year since 2021. And it does absolutely, for, you know, that's reached, I think, it's been, ooh, in the first 2 years of the fund, 3,500 grants nearly were dispersed. So very small sums of money sprinkled like stardust across the country and doing really impactful, magical work. So you're right, it doesn't, you know, some, and I think the beauty of that fund, it works really closely with communities. I think it goes through third sector interface. So that's how it's people who really know what's happening in the community, and it has, I mean, The pleasure I see is that everywhere I go, I can see the impact of that money in every, literally every community in Scotland. So you're absolutely right. And that, I mean, I will be fighting for that money to continue, as you might expect. But I think I'm pushing against an open door because we recognise the impact that it has, and it meets a number of our targets. So, you know, it's not just, again, not solely about suicide prevention. It is about strengthening communities, and by strengthening communities, we can achieve a huge number of our aims as both central government and local government.
Those phenomenal organisations working across the country in all different forms in different areas, and actually the small pockets of money that they, what they can do with that money and the impact they can have in communities, and so many organisations that do that. But I think critically that local government often funds a lot of those organisations. So when we're having our budgets been exceptionally difficult. You know, it does prove challenging, and most local authorities are still funding them and committed to doing it, but that's part of something we need to look at the strategy, because these organisations are vitally important for the work that they do, and often very connected to groups and individuals in our communities that maybe sometimes local authorities and government aren't. So, yeah, absolutely, there's a commitment there, and you know, continually be raised between local and national government to give that support.
Thanks for that.
We'll have a question from Paul, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. I think building on that theme around funding and around, I suppose, sustainability of funding, in the previous exchange I had with the Minister in this session this morning, I think you mentioned men's sheds, or certainly men's groups, as being vitally important. The evidence we heard from the Men's Shed Association was the challenges in terms of sustainability of funding. In the intervening period, obviously, government had to rethink its withdrawal of funding to the Men's Shed Association. But really, what we were hearing from them is they have no sufficiency in order to plan, because they don't have in excess of sometimes 6 months to a year's funding. And crucially, what I kept asking third sector organisations who came is, what is the challenge within that? And what we heard is the challenge is about being able to test what works and to test change, but also to give security to people who obviously feel that those organisations are literally a lifeline. So I wonder if the Minister might want to, you know, reflect on, will the government be moving towards, as it has promised for a long time now, that more sustainable and longer term funding?
Yeah, there's certainly at government level a recognition that our third sector needs to be valued and supported, and that multi-year funding would be a way of improving the sustainability for them. They expend a great deal of energy living hand to mouth and lose a lot of talent because of the way that their funding is. The challenge has been, I mean, I think there was a commitment to do that within government, and then the pandemic hit, and the challenge has been getting back on course for that. So there's no lack of understanding at government level on how difficult that is for our third sector organisations, and there's no lack of appreciation for the incredible and impactful work that they do, but getting from the emergency footing that we have been on in the last few years to that more sustainable.
Interject. I mean, I take that point, but I think subsequently, I mean, as recently as a gathering last year, the former First Minister was making the commitment to three-year funding. So we are some time beyond COVID. So is that still something the government is committed to? And is it something certainly where you would have influence on funding within the health budget you would be looking to move forward?
Yeah, certainly. I'll ask Morag to come in, but certainly that is a conversation that is still going on across government. We find ourselves in very difficult times in the last number of years, but we would expect to get back on a sustainable footing at some point. The other thing that we do is provide support. So I think in the discussion around men's sheds, what you heard was a commitment from government to helping them to get onto a more sustainable footing than they are currently, so that they're more resilient in future years than they have been up until now. But Morag?
Yeah. Just focusing down on the delivery model we have for the current three-year action plan, it was very clear to us that the best way of delivering this action plan was to work with organisations who have expertise and very much working in the field of suicide prevention. And we're absolutely delighted that for each of the four outcomes that we have a strategic outcome lead partner. For three of those outcomes, they are third sector organisations. So we work with Samaritans Scotland on outcome one, we work with SAMH on outcome two, and on outcome three, we work with Penumbra and Change Mental Health. And they are leading the delivery of those outcomes along with HALIS. And those organisations have been appointed to that role for the 3 years of the action plan, recognising very much that we want to be able to work in partnership. We need to be able to not be working on just a one-year cycle, but to have longevity. So that's very much kind of embedded within the partnership model that we've put in place for the action plan.
Thank you. I wonder if I can ask a similar question in terms of local government. So we understand the pressures that are on local government in terms of being able to deliver more sustainable funding within local communities as well, and particularly, you know, third sector groups that are within and funded by local authorities are feeling that challenge. So I wonder if Councillor Kelly might want to reflect on that and the challenges that local government are facing.
I think COS has been very clear. We want to, in terms of our budget process, want to see a fair settlement to local government. We want to see multi-year budgets because we want to give that security to third sector and other organisations in local authority areas of that funding that we struggle to do when we are dealing with significant budget reductions every year. But you will see, as I said earlier, a lot of local authorities still committed despite how difficult it is, and probably one of the most difficult budgets we've ever faced, to working with these third sector organisations as best we can to support them, particularly because a number of them do tie in to the work of the strategy, as I've outlined earlier, but also tie into the mental health and wellbeing strategy and are critical partners to local authorities. And we could not do the jobs we do around areas like suicide prevention or mental health and wellbeing without them. So this is something that is absolutely critical in the dialogue we're having with government. And as you can imagine, COSLA does have that on a regular basis. But that funding is absolutely critical to those third sector organisations and us being able to give them that security as well.
Paul, question from Annie, please.
Thanks, convener. The Minister mentioned that her earlier contribution that the annual progress report was due out this summer. And I was just wanting to know whether the Suicide Prevention Delivery Collective was set to deliver that, and also will details of spending be included in the annual report?
I haven't heard of any delay. I think we should be on
schedule. Okay for July.
We should be good. I mean, summer is quite a loose term, isn't it?
Yes.
In civil service terms, every season's quite long, but yeah. I should think that we will be able to. I'm not sure if there's an outturn as part of that. Is there?
Yes, so we have provided information to Parliament on the 23-24 spend through parliamentary questions. We can certainly include that in the annual report. And going forward in our delivery plan for future years, we will also include an outline of that budget, how that budget is being spent, so that it's kind of proactively shared, and we're really content to do that. Yeah.
Thank you, convener. Thank you.
I'd like to ask, members have heard that a more cohesive approach to collecting healthcare data, such as improving access to primary care data, could help identify people of at risk of suicide. Can I ask what actions are being taken to improve healthcare data to better identify these individuals? Minister.
I'm happy to contribute, and others will chip in, I'm sure. Yeah. So within Public Health Scotland, obviously they're the leads for Outcome 4, which is really looking at the data and evidence that we have. We've been working over a period of time now to ensure we've got more timely data on deaths by suicide, so local areas are able to have that information really quite quickly now, within a few weeks, months of somebody dying by suicide. So we are improving that. We are also looking at how we can capture that information about suicide attempt and self-harm, working closely with colleagues on the self-harm strategy to do that within PHS, looking at how we get that, but not just within the health settings, because I think it's important to see where else we can capture evidence that will help support us in our work. So we're looking at data that Police Scotland collect through their negotiations and their vulnerable person databases. We're looking at data that the ambulance service collect. We're looking at third sector organisations and the data that they collect as well, really trying to get a sense of what information is out there before we look at how we improve that, so that we're not duplicating effort. So that's really where we're at the moment, is just really mapping what data sources we're aware of and then looking at where the gaps are.
Thank you.
helpful. Dr. Cook.
Dr. wants to come in. Yeah. I mean, I think as well as the general picture of data and the concern with collecting it, and we have a concern generally in mental health around the quality of data and the availability of data, and we are working hard to improve that as part of our mental health and wellbeing strategy. There are often when a suicide has occurred, in many circumstances, there is an extra level of investigation into that. Yeah. And there is a lot of learning comes from that. And a common theme is that transfer of information across interfaces. So that's we absolutely recognise that that's an important piece of work that needs to be embedded generally across the system, that key information or key data is made available across these interfaces as people work their way through the system.
The topic of data and the quality of data across healthcare has come up in a number of different areas, and that Public Health Scotland are particularly working on the primary care data issue, not with a specific focus around suicide prevention, but then there will be opportunities through that outcome to pick up on that, we had the discussion with the Public Audit Committee just before Christmas, and their report looking at data very much around the wider mental health field, and we are committed to producing the mental health dashboard. I think it's November is the plan for that, which will be significant in helping us with some of these areas.
That's helpful. Thank you. Well, thank you. Do the members have any other questions they wish to ask? No. That brings our evidence session to a close. I want to thank the panel once again for attending this morning, and we will now suspend while we go into private session to discuss the final items on our agenda.